Hi folks, Lance here from TriggerShims.com. In this video, I'm going to show you how easy it is to install Hammer and Hammer Dog Shims in a reduced power hammer spring in this Ruger Super RedHawk Alaskan. Now this gun's already been safety checked, there's no ammunition on the bench, the gun's been checked and cleared, but always make certain that safety comes first when working on firearms. Now the first thing we need to do is remove the grip, and I've already taken the grip screw off, so we'll just slide the grip off. Next thing we need to do is remove the hammer strut and spring assembly, and to do that what we're going to do is we're going to cock the hammer. Take your hammer disassembly pin or a small punch and put in your disassembly hole on the main strut, and then just release the tension off the hammer like that. Now we've got the main strut free, okay. Now pay attention to the way this comes out. You'll see that there's a round ball here, but this isn't exactly symmetrical. It's a little bit, there's a little more of an angle here on the front than there is in the back. It's a little bit straighter in the back. And then you'll also notice here in the bottom plate, you see it's got some teeth in a round notch out of it there. And that bottom plate sets in with those teeth in the front right here. So pay good attention to that when you disassemble that so that you know which way everything came apart, so that you know that when you put it back together your teeth are going to face forward and the longer angle is going to face forward. The ball kind of tends to want to rounded towards the front if you look at it real close. Now another thing you can do when you've got this hammer strut out, and I've already done it with this one, is these are stampings, metal stampings, and so they're going to be a little bit rough on the one side, which would be the side opposite that the die stamped the part. And what I did is I just took a small diamond hone and I took the rough edge off the back side, and then I kind of smoothed it off on top. I didn't take hardly any material off, I just smoothed it off a little bit. Okay, we're going to set that aside. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to take the hammer out. Now, in order to do that, what we want to do is pull the trigger, hold back on the trigger, and get it over on either side here. That'll take the pressure off of the hammer pin, okay? So we can just lift it right out over on here on this side. Now, once in a while, they'll be a little tough and they won't come out. If that's the case, and that's the way this one is here, what I do is I use a little Delrin punch and just tap that a little bit non-marring punch. You want to make sure you don't mar anything up. And we're just going to tap that just a little bit to get that started out. Okay, I'm going to pull my trigger to take the spring pressure off. Just lift that off like that. Set that aside. Now what I can do is just lift the hammer. Out it comes just like that. Release the trigger. And that takes care of that. Now we want to measure the hammer with it inside the frame. We also want to measure the hammer dog clearances with the pin removed from that, and I'll show you why here in just a second. So let's set this back in here. First thing we're going to do is measure the hammer clearances. I want to get this lined back up again so that it would, so I could put the pin back in if I wanted to. And I want to start to measure my clearances. I'm going to use a ordinary feeler gauge, the kind you can get at any automotive store or most hardware stores, and let's start with 10 thousandths. Now these are an old set I've had for years, so I kind of gotta look real close to see what the measurements are on it, but 10 thousandths will fit right in there, so I know I've got at least 10 thousandths clearance. So let's go up a little bit, let's go to 12. Yeah, 12 will fit right in, and I'm going right straight down in. I want to go right down in across where our pin is, and that'll fit right in, because that's where our shims are going to go. Our shims are going to set right down in there. I'm going to move up to 14. 14 fits in, again, just slides right in. But we're getting a little closer. Let's try a 15. Okay, 15 slides in. It's a little tight right there, but it slides in. Next we're going to try a 16. Yeah, 16 will slide in too. So we'll keep moving up. Here's a 17. Okay, the 17, I can't get it to go all the way in. I can get it to start in part way. Oh, we just had I pulled it back out and I moved the trigger or the hammer around a little bit and we got it better. It slid right in there. So let's keep moving up. Here's an 18. And it takes a little time and a little finesse to move your parts around and get these measured right. Now the 18 is not going to go in. Well, there it goes. There, we worked into place and slid in. So we got a little spot there. We must have a high spot on, but by moving the hammer back and forth, and again, I'm still lined up at the point where I can see right through my hammer pin area right there, and I'm still lined up there. And now we've got the 18 thousandths feeler gauge to go in. So let's keep going. The 19. And if we wiggle the hammer back and forth a little bit and work it, we can get the 19 to go in there. It's starting to get snug now though. And here's a 20. Okay, now the 20 won't go all the way in, it'll only go matter of fact, depending on where that hammer's sitting at, it's even hard to start. So we can get the 20 just started, but it won't go in. So we're gonna say that we've got 19 thousandths clearance there. Now if you go by a general rule of thumb, you want to end up with maybe 3 to 4 thousandths ending clearance. That's not too tight. It should be just plenty loose enough where it won't give you any interference or anything like that. So if we use that rule of thumb and go to 3 to 4, we ended up 19 thousandths clearance. Let's take 3 off of that, give ourselves an ending clearance of 3 thousandths. So we'll take the 19 and minus 3 and it equals 16. So with 16 thousandths, we're going to end up with 2 8-thousandths shims there, and I think that'll fit just about right in that spot. Now let's move on. What we're going to do is take the hammer back out. What we want to do now is remove the hammer dog, and we want to take the pin out. There's a little plunger behind it. You'll see it spring-loaded. If you look very closely at the hammer dog, there we go. You can see it's spring-loaded there. We want to take this little pin out. We need a punch to do it. Now normally they're just the spring is about all the tension that's holding that pin in there. It's not anything you got to drive out. So we're just going to take our same disassembly punch that we used for taking our mainspring out, and I'm going to push down a little bit on this dog and then just kind of push on that pin and work it. There it goes. And I got it to slide over, and that's all I needed to do. Okay. Now we'll lift the hammer dog out. Now you notice again the orientation of the hammer dog. If you were to draw a line across the middle of your hammer dog here, the hole that we took this pin out of is above the center line. So that means the long leg of the hammer dog is going to face downward. Okay, now here's your pin from your hammer dog. We're going to go ahead and take that right on out, set it aside so we know where it's at and we don't lose it. Now there's also a little plunger and a spring down deep inside your hammer right here. If I can get some light in that so you can see it. But inside there's a little plunger and spring. We're going to knock that out of there. There we go. There's a little plunger and spring that we took out of the hammer. Now set that right down here next to our pin. Now we can measure our hammer dog clearance. Very easy to do. We're just going to set the dog back in, and we want to take the feeler gauge right straight in where the hammer pin would have been. Now I want to tell you one thing you want to watch for on all these measurements. None of this stuff is perfect, and it's not always exactly square, absolutely square. This recess that this dog sets in, this is a cast hammer. investment cast. Ruger makes a lot of stuff out of investment cast. This inside pocket here is not machined. It was cast in, so it's not going to be perfectly square walled. It's going to be really close, but it's not going to be perfect. But when you're measuring it, you got to allow for that, a little bit of taper. Let's start out. It looked to me like we had a little bit of room there. So let's start out with the 8/1000ths feeler gauge. Looked like we had some room. We might be able to get an 8 in there. Let's see. So I got an 8/1000ths here. Oh yeah, that slides right in there without any trouble at all. Let's move up up the ladder. Here's a 9. And the 9 goes right in, so let's keep going. We'll jump. Let's jump the 10 and we'll go up to 11. Still got plenty. Slides right in there. There's our 12. Let's jump one. We'll go to 13. Now there, the 13 doesn't really want to go all the way in. It'll start in, and it'll go about to where the pin's at, or a little bit farther, but it doesn't want to bottom out very well there. Let's put that... There we go. We'll move back and forth a little bit. Yeah, we can get the 13. Well, it's got a couple tight spots right there. So we're going to say 13 would be our maximum clearance there. It's probably just a hair less. We jumped over the 12. Let's see how that fits in there. Yeah, 12 fits right in there, and the 13 is just a little snug. So we're going to call it 13 because we got the 13 the most of the way in there. And using our rule of thumb, which is 3/4000ths ending clearance. Now on your Hammer Dog, you can go a little bit less. So if you're kind of at the borderline with 3, you could drop down to 2/1000ths clearance. We're at a tight 13 here, so if we take the 13, we'll say that 3 is pretty tight. That we had that 13 in there, we'll take 3 off for our ending clearance, and we could put 2/5000ths shims in this, Hammer Dog shims in this. I think that's what we'll do. So we're going to put 2/5000ths here, and we ended up on this, we ended up around, what do we end up around, 19, 20, where did we end up at? Trying to remember. Yeah, that's where we ended up at, was at 19/1000ths on that clearance there. So let's make sure we got our spring and plunger in our pin here. We're going to go ahead and put our Hammer Dog shims in. So what I want to do, I want to put a little bit of oil down in where the plunger and spring set. So we're going to go down in just put a little tiny bit of oil down in there. There we go. Just bring the plunger back in. What I'm going to do, I'm going to set the Hammer Dog in here. And put the pin back in. There we go. Now I'm only going to let it go in part way. I'm not going to let it go through far enough. What I want to do is I want to be able to slide my shims in from the outside here. Now I've got 2/5000ths shims here. Start with one right here. I'll pull that pin back just a little bit. There we go. I'm going to slide that pin, that shim in place there. I can see it looking through the top. You probably can't because of the camera angle and everything. Not quite exactly where we want it at yet. Drop it, make it go forward a little bit. Here's where your feeler gauges come in handy. There we go. I get that to line up just a little bit there. And there we go. We brought the pin the rest of the way through. So we got that shim in the one side. Now let's push this pin through the other way. Get our other 5/1000 shim. Lined up there. And there. There we got the hammer dog shimmed. I'll put just a little tiny bit of oil on that. And that's it for that. So there you've got your shims on your hammer dog. And got that back in place. Now we had had 19/1000 clearance on the hammer, when it was set in place down in here. Now, there's a couple ways you can do this. One way that the way I've showed before in other videos is to take a little bit of gun grease and put on your hammer. Just takes a little tiny bit, that's a real thin grease. You can use most any grease is fine. All you got to do is just a little tiny thin little coating on there, and then take your shim. Man, that'll sit there like glue almost. You can move it around, but it'll stay in place. It won't go anywhere. Depends on how close you're shimming them. Now, sometimes if you're shimming them a little tighter, you might not be able to get both of the shims glued to the hammer and still get it to slide back in, but most generally you can. There. Let's give that a try. I want to watch through the hole down there and see if I can see the shim come through, and I can. So I know I'm in place on this one side because I was able to watch it. Move the hammer around a little bit. Yeah, I can see the shim on this side. It's slid over out of the way here. Let me get it slid back down in where it belongs. Check this side and see how we're doing. There, I can see that. I can see through the hole. I can see the shim on this side, so we know we're good here. And I saw I pushed it into place on this side, so we know we're good there. So I'm gonna use this pencil or this little wooden tool to kind of line things up like that. I'm gonna take my hammer pin. There we go. Set it back in place, and that's got it. That's got it in both ways. We've got the hammer shim in, and we tightened up a lot of that side-to-side play in the hammer. I think we're going to stop any rubbing that we had along the sides of the hammer when it would go in and out of the frame there. It's going to make the whole thing a lot smoother. By putting the hammer dogs in, your hammer dog is what your trigger pushes against when it pulls your hammer back in double action mode. So it should make your, if you, now that you got a straighter, better pull there without having that hammer dog flopping over and laying over to the side. You should get a better double action trigger pull out of it. Now all we've got to do is put our mainspring back in place. Now I told you we were going to change the mainspring on this. I think now the factory mainspring is a 14 pound spring. And what we're going to do with this gun today is we're going to put an 11 pound spring in to replace it. So what I've got is a piece of hardwood here with a hole drilled in it that I can socket my main strut down there like that, so I can get it to set in place and I won't lose it and fly off the bench. I'm just going to grab the spring and push down and pull my punch out and release it. Now don't forget the orientation on your seat here, that your main spring seat. Take your spring off, and I've got a replacement here. This is a Wolff 11 pound reduced power spring, and then all we've got to do is push that on and put our punch back in place. Like that. There we go. So now we've changed out the spring. We've put a little bit lighter spring in there. That's going to help us with our trigger pull. Now, Wolff makes a 12, 11, a 10, and a 9-pound hammer spring. And if you want to put reduced power springs in your revolver, I think it's, we sell a lot of them, and we have a lot of guys that really like them, and they work great. If I was going after Alaskan grizzly bears with my Ruger RedHawk Alaskan, I don't think I'd go less than 12 pounds, but certainly whatever size I went with, I would try it out and qualify it and make sure that it was everything, the ammo I was going to fire. We didn't have any light strikes or anything like that. I've never heard of any light strikes with the 12 pound, the 11 pound. Once in a great while somebody said something about the 10 pound, but the 9 pounds, you do have to make sure that you've got it tested out if you use the 9 pound reduced power hammer spring. Now I put a little grease on the end of my main strut there. I'll put that back in, get up in the hammer where it's supposed to go. This is kind of clumsy to do on the camera at the same time. There we go. And that's it. There you've got a set of hammer shims. Set of hammer dog shims in your Ruger double action pistol. Now this pistol has a really snug trigger on it. There was not any room, so we didn't do a disassembly for the trigger shims on this, but if you find you've got a loose trigger, I do make trigger shims for these guns, and I do make a video. It's the I've got another video on YouTube that shows us tearing it down and installing the shims on the trigger on another Ruger double action, so you can take a look at that if you need to watch that video to put those in. And that's all there is to that, guys. Pretty easy little job to make a nice improvement on your revolver. I have a lot of people ask me if that'll cure the marks, the wear marks that get on the sides of your hammer from going inside in and out of the frame. And you got to know that if the hammer is rubbing the frame like it was right there, if you can see that little bit of mark right there, if the hammer's rubbing the frame, then it's got to be some friction there and some drag, and it's not performing to top notch like it could be. So those shims will help to keep that hammer centered up and stop it from rubbing that frame when it goes in and out. And that's it. I appreciate you taking time to watch our video today. Stop by my website, TriggerShims.com, and have a look at our products. Until then, thanks a lot. Take care, good shooting, and God bless.